this is a project, as Catherine said, is looking at water in northeastern Brazil. It's a team of economists and engineers who came together to solve a measurement problem. And Majid is actually going to, who's our engineer out of Cara Nelson's lab, is going to talk a bit about how we actually did the measurement. Really, water access in rural areas especially is a major problem throughout the world. 800 million people live without access to piped clean water and actually have to go out and collect it, spending a lot of time and a lot of energy filling up containers to bring back to the household. And in lots of parts of the world, in northeast Brazil where we're working, there's tremendous months where there's no rainfall, it's hot and dry, and the water sources themselves tend to dry up, and what remains has serious quality problems. So we're going 5-6 months, enormous amounts of time and energy to collect and clean whatever water is available. It has not only health effects, but economic effects on the household. A solution that the Brazilian government is investing in fact, the current president is committed to building 1 million water cisterns to distribute throughout the country free to the cisterns. And this is a picture of the cistern, which is basically a large sealed storage facility. And it collects water off the roof, so it's a rain-fed solution. This is not only happening in Brazil, it's also India and a lot of other countries using similar technologies. They're moving away from these cement containers to plastic and other cheaper materials. And our being in the right place in the right time at a meeting in Rio in the right bar at the right time of night with Brazilian government officials and Spanish aid representatives who happened to be before the financial crisis. So they said, well, we'd like to really see if this works since we're funding the Brazilian government to do that. So we have a large randomized trial looking at the rollout of these cisterns in northeastern Brazil. And the real question became when we started looking at this was rather than just looking at cisterns versus no cisterns, a big question became, well, is there enough rain to really fill up these cisterns enough so they could last during the dry season? How much roof space would you need to collect enough water? So maybe the roof surface area was too small. After you got the water in the cistern, did people use it really fast so it ran out? What was the quality of those data? And so it wasn't just looking at final outcomes of time use and health impact. We really wanted to start looking at water management issues related to temperature, rainfall, the length of the dry season, and things like that. Economists think we can just ask people these things. Lucas, how much water did you use last month? Well, in California, we know, but it turns out that's really hard to answer. And we wanted not just a single point in time, but we wanted many frequent measurements so we could correlate with time-varying factors like rainfall, also political elections, because it turns out bribes for votes are all about bringing water into areas. So we had this randomized trial had a major disruption to the vote-buying corruption going on in Brazil, and that's a separate project we can talk about later. And so the question was, how are we going to measure these things? Luckily, Berkeley has given a way out to us economists. We have an established collaboration with engineers who actually know how to do things. And so we approached Cara Nelson and her lab, and she introduced us to Majid. And they came up with a solution which we're able to measure this stuff. And so I'll turn it over to Majid to actually tell you something that you're probably interested in.
So I just wanted to talk a little bit about the sensors we use to objectively measure these answering questions. And yeah, here's a specimen that you can pass around and take a look at.
Yeah, it's a bit like show and tell this.
So the sensors, this is one of them. They run on AA batteries. They measure the water volume in the sensor and the cistern every hour. They work by, so They're mounted in the roof of the cistern, and they emit an ultrasonic pulse, hits the water, is reflected back, and based on that we can tell the water level. And then from the water level, we can tell the volume of water in the cistern. Let's take a look at some actual data from these sensors. So, as I'm sure many of you guys know, these sensors produce a lot of noise, they have random errors, and in this case, it also picked up some reflection from different angles, they bouncing off the walls of the cistern. So we wrote a computer program to sort of find those errors automatically. It marked them in red there on the left side, and then eliminate them. These two graphs are sort of just showing water volume with time, and after running the filtering program, we get the results on the right.
So you can see where there's rain.
Yeah, that's the big jump up. We wanted to answer some questions about, like, just for preliminary analysis, what kind of factors drive water consumption rate? So, for example, how many liters a week a family is using? So I was going to look at one specific sensor. This is number 16, and this is just its time series graph showing water volume as time goes on. And so I'm going to look at two factors that might possibly explain water usage rate. One could be the amount of water in the cistern at a given time. So if there's more water in the cistern, our family's going to be using more water. And as it lowers, are they going to start rationing more tightly? And then another more obvious idea is just weather. If it's hot or summer, are they going to be using more water than winter? So looking at sensor number 16, I plotted water consumption rate in liters per week and plotted that versus water volume in the cistern. And it just kind of looks like a big blob. There's no real correlation or anything you can tell from that. On the other hand, looking at the one that's versus time on the other side, you can kind of see that the water consumption rate definitely falls in the summer. So actually in this region of Brazil, summer's in January, February, and March. And August, September, October, November, December, when it's very, very hot. And you can see the water consumption rates are a little bit higher on average there. In the middle, in winter, where it's just slightly less hot, April, May, June, July, that's when the water consumption is falling a little bit. And so I tried to look at these same patterns in a multitude of sensors, like say a sample of 25 of them. And so I drew box and whisker plots showing the spread of all those sensors. And it's much harder to discern a pattern in this data. And I didn't really detect the same winter, summer usage patterns in this. But it's an area of ongoing research. So here's some future analysis ideas we have. So one big objective is to determine the optimal size of the roof for catching rainwater. We may want to understand better ideas about the reliability. We had big trouble with the humidity and temperature in the cisterns, which definitely impacted battery life. And another idea is maybe finding a way to give this data back to the people whose cistern it is, and maybe allowing it to better ration their water, understand weather patterns, and how they can affect them. And that's all. Great.